All right, well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Rob Atkinson, I'm president of ICIF, and I want to welcome you here to an event to discuss new recommendations and a report from the mHealth Task Force. We're really honored that the task force and Chairman Genachowski asked us to host this event, because it's really one of the critical questions, I think, as we face going forward in the country. How do we begin to transform our healthcare system and bring it into the 21st century? And mHealth, or in other words, IT communications and health, are a critical way to do that. This is actually the task force is releasing a pre-publication public draft report today of their efforts, the mHealth task force findings and recommendations. And this is, I think, probably sets the record for the fastest government turnaround ever of work. Chairman Genachowski convened this group of experts just in June of this year to bring together a group of experts to talk about how mHealth could be a driver of change, and what, in particular, the role of the federal government and specifically the FCC was in doing that. And less than 3 months later, we have this interim report coming out. So really very expeditious work. I'm going to introduce our four speakers today, and then we'll hear from Chairman Genachowski, who has to leave at some point in the middle of this, and then we'll hear from our three chairs here. Chairman Genachowski, obviously chairman of the Federal Communications Commission. He was nominated for that position in March of 2009 by President Obama, and he was sworn into office in June of 2009. Prior to being FCC commissioner, he spent more than 10 years working in the technology industry as an executive and entrepreneur, co-founding Launchbox Digital and Rock Creek Ventures, where he served as managing director and was also special advisor at General Atlantic. From 1997 to 2005, he was a senior executive at IAC Interactive Corporation, which is a Fortune 500 internet e-commerce company, where his positions include chief of business operations and general counsel. And prior to that, from 94 to 97, Chairman Genachowski was the chief counsel to then FCC Chairman Reed Hunt, and before that, special counsel to then FCC General Counsel Bill Kennard, who, as you all know, later became chairman. He's also worked as a law clerk in the Supreme Court and a congressional staffer, and has a long background in both the nexus of Washington and technology, which is, in many cases, a unique vantage point. Next, we'll hear from Dr. Julian Goldman, who is the medical director of Biomedical Engineering Partners Healthcare System. He's also a principal anesthesiologist at Massachusetts General Hospital Operating Room of the Future, and director of the program on the medical device interoperability at MGH, and also the Center for Integration of Medicine and Innovative Technology. In 2004, he founded the Medical Device Plug-and-Play Interoperability Program to promote innovation in patient safety and clinical care. He also serves on the NSF CISE Advisory Committee, and a visiting scholar in the FDA Medical Device Fellowship Program, and a number of other honors and awards. Robert Jarrin is the Senior Director of Government Affairs for Qualcomm, the wireless corporate company. He advises Qualcomm on matters relating to wireless health and life sciences, including FDA regulatory oversight of converged medical devices, healthcare legislative affairs, CMS technology reimbursement, and the regulation of health IT. He also serves as the co-chair of the U.S. Policy Working Group for the Continua Health Alliance, and he leads the American Telemedicine Association A-Team on telehealth and meaningful use. And is also chair of the European American Business Council E-Health Policy Group. And last, Douglas Trauner, who is the CEO of Health Analytics Services and also the Carrot.com, which he launched in 2007. To enable healthcare providers to improve the management of outpatient care. He's a frequent speaker on the subject of patient engagement and privacy, and previously founded PM Squared Inc., a healthcare information company that was acquired by United Healthcare. So with that, Mr. Chairman, if you want to take us away, get us going.
Thank you, Rob. And thanks to all of you for being here, for coming out. I see a lot of familiar faces, including Carrie McDermott, who led our national broadband plan work on mHealth and you know, that whole work product, the national broadband plan, and the section in it on broadband and health is something that I continue to be really proud of that guides our work. And there's a direct line between the work that Kerry and a lot of other people in the national broadband plan team did and what we'll be talking about today. I assume everyone got a copy of this book on their chair. I did.
There we go.
It's fine.
You've got to put it in airplane.
I think it was the book somehow.
It might be the book.
Congratulations on the book.
It has an airplane chip in it so that no one steals it.
An innovative breakthrough. No, but like all Rob's work, it's an important contribution to these discussions and debates and topics of real importance. And one of the core points in the book is that only through the development of innovative products and services and business models will the U.S. be able to lead in the 21st century. Of course, that's completely true. I couldn't agree more. It's defined our work at the FCC, and it specifically defined the approach we've taken in the mHealth area. It certainly characterizes the thinking and the lives and the focus of these three terrific people who made up this group. And you'll hear about the recommendations, Dr. Julian Goldman, Robert Jarrin of Qualcomm, Douglas Trauner of Health Analytics, for taking, you know, the concept of an mHealth task force and responding to the challenge to help us focus all this good stuff on concrete, actionable ideas with the goal of accelerating the rollout and adoption of all the opportunities around mHealth. Of course, none of them got paid for this. It was all completely voluntary. And I know how hard they worked to produce what really is a terrific product that will make an important contribution in our work, and I think more broadly in the work of harnessing the opportunities of mHealth. I have a history here that I guess this is in the For What It's Worth department, but I've always cared a lot about this, you know, partly because my parents wanted me to be a doctor. But that actually took hold with me in some ways. Back when I was in college, I taught CPR. I got certified as an EMT. I worked on the Columbia Area Volunteer Ambulance at Columbia College, where I went to make a little spending money. I worked for a private ambulance service in New York City. This was the beginning of the end of my career directly in healthcare. One of the drivers I worked with in the ambulance in Manhattan, like nothing more than driving the wrong way up a one-way avenue in New York at all hours of the night. And I decided that law and business might be a better career path for me. But I've always admired the men and women who make healthcare a career choice. And it was a very easy, natural thing for me to do to make mHealth a priority of us at the FCC, even though it's not necessarily what people think of when they think about the FCC. But it is important and informs, you know, more broadly some of our thinking. Since 2009, when I arrived, we focused the agency on broadband, on wired and wireless broadband, and on harnessing the opportunities of this incredible advanced communications platform for all Americans. And when you think about it, the opportunities are manifold. There are real opportunities for our economy, for job creation. Rob talks about some of them in his book, and he's been talking about this for a long time. And so obviously that's a hugely important topic to us. But you can look at virtually every vertical of importance in the United States. And the fact is that wired and wireless broadband is transforming that vertical and thinking carefully and wisely about what we all can do to harness the opportunities of that transformation, to accelerate that, is really important. And so education is an area where that's true. We've been spending a lot of time. We have great people like Jordan Eustan who are working not only on this but on that. There are other team members here. We've done some great work with Arnie Duncan at the Education Department. Energy is an area. Public safety is a vertical where the opportunities are vast. And then, of course, there's healthcare. And we've seen over the last several years a steady stream of new examples of the ways that broadband technology, particularly wireless technology, can transform medicine. So just this month, researchers at Stanford unveiled a tiny new pacemaker, so small it could fit on the head of a pin. And instead of using batteries for power, the pacemaker is charged by a wireless transmitter from outside the body, avoiding the need for battery packs that require surgery to replace. Better experience for patients, better outcomes. Earlier this year, those same researchers developed a medical sensor so small it could float through a patient's blood vessels, powered by, this is amazing, the patient's own pulse. Applications of the technology, also wireless-based, include everything from diagnostic tests to minimally invasive surgeries. Just last week, the West Health Institute announced that it's licensing technology to wirelessly monitor high-risk pregnancies in remote clinics. Technologies like this Sense for Baby system could result in healthier babies and mothers and result in hundreds of millions of dollars in cost savings in our system. And today, products like a smart pillbox can send wireless automatic reminders to a patient to take her daily medication, alert her physician or family members if she skips it. Wireless remote medical monitoring increases independence, increases mobility, increases comfort for patients at home or in the hospital, and companies are innovating to create smaller, better, more reliable monitors every day. Now, the FCC, we've already taken a number of actions tracing back to the broadband plan to enable our healthcare ecosystem to seize the opportunities of these new technologies. I'm going to use the word mHealth to embrace all of it, with a chief focus on mobile and medicine, but the truth is we mean it also to include all broadband communications. In 2010, I mentioned our national broadband plan. The plan I mentioned includes a chapter. We've been implementing since then the recommendations of the plan in this area. For example, we entered into an unprecedented partnership with the Food and Drug Administration to help ensure that communications-related medical innovations can swiftly and safely be brought to market. Last November, the FCC dedicated spectrum for medical micropower networks, which have the potential, literally, to enable paraplegics to stand and to restore sight to the blind. These are amazing technologies. They require spectrum. Spectrum is the responsibility of the FCC. And focusing on what we ought to do speedily and efficiently to unlock these opportunities and to incentivize innovators is at the core of our work. That was one example. Another is something called M-band devices, medical body area networks. We made the U.S. the first country in the world to authorize the use of spectrum for M-bands. M-bands provide a cost-effective way to monitor patients wirelessly, providing more information to doctors and giving patients mobility and greater independence. Basically, they untether patients at hospitals from the cords that connect them to various monitoring devices. And the data on the improvements to outcomes from this is very impressive. This will eventually extend to the home as well. It's a very exciting thing. We did that announcement in June, and as we were doing these different pieces, we realized that we needed to step back and ask ourselves, what are the concrete steps we can do to accelerate the opportunities of mHealth? Let's take the work we did in the National Broadband Plan and think fresh 2 years later about what concretely we can do. And I convened an mHealth summit to tackle this, and we invited senior executives and leaders from the healthcare technology industry, the academy, government to discuss these new opportunities and challenges. I was very impressed. I think our RSVP ratio was extremely high, and it was a a promising thing for us, even at the beginning stage, when we reached out to just terrific people from a cross-section of parts of the ecosystem that don't always deal with the FCC. And we asked them to be part of a collaborative effort to work on this plan, work on this blueprint, make progress. The response was terrific. We set goals as part of that process of harnessing these technologies to improve the quality of care, lower costs, save lives. And we asked the group for specific ideas on how to remove barriers to harnessing this technology. Many of the barriers are known. Interoperability, reliability, connectivity, privacy, security. I'm finding this in multiple areas. Education has similar dynamics, where enough smart people have been talking about these for a while that actually it's not that hard now to identify what the concrete barriers that are slowing down adoption and penetration. And the real work now that needs to be done collaboratively between people in the private sector, the academy, doctors in this case, and others is, okay, we agree on what the problems are, now what do we do? And that's where the task force started heading. And we organized this group to take that work further and to come back with concrete recommendations that weren't boil the ocean type recommendations, but that would make a real material difference on this acceleration concept that I keep coming back to, because that's what we wanted to do. I do think at some level, the tides here are so strong that eventually, as a society, we'll figure it out. It's up to us how quickly it is. It's up to us whether we're in the first, whether we're the first country in the world to figure it out, which will make us the place, the home, the hub for innovation in this area in the future. That's something that isn't inevitable. And that's part of why we did this work, because we want to get these benefits for Americans as quickly as possible and simultaneously make America the first country in the world to figure all this stuff out, so that we can continue to attract and keep the world's great innovators in this area here. So today, I'm really pleased we take another step forward in our mHealth agenda with the release of the mHealth Task Force's report. The report goes through the barriers that we talked about, and importantly makes recommendations to the FCC, other federal agencies, and industry. The report also proposes a bold and important national goal, which today I'm challenging public and private sector leaders to work together to achieve. The goal is to make the use of mHealth technology a routine medical best practice within 5 years. Furthermore, I'm proud to announce that the FCC will take a series of actions to implement key recommendations in today's report. Yes. We were alerted in advance about what was coming. So first, the FCC will consider an order by the end of this year, the end of this calendar year, to streamline our experimental licensing rules to promote and encourage the creation of wireless health test beds in the United States to permit easier testing of mHealth devices. That's one. Two. The FCC will consider an order by the end of this calendar year to comprehensively reform and modernize the rural healthcare program, including permitting networks of hospitals and healthcare facilities to jointly apply for program funds in order to boost broadband capacity and enable adoption of electronic health records. The order will also advance the task force's recommendation to collect richer data on broadband and telehealth to enable better targeting of support in the rural healthcare program. Third, I am directing the FCC's International Bureau to work with our counterparts in other countries to encourage them to make spectrum available for M-bands, the mobile body area networks that I talked about, and to drive toward spectrum harmonization to allow for medically safe cross-border patient travel and better economies of scale for device makers. This was a suggestion that we first heard at our mHealth meeting at the FCC. I thought it was a terrific suggestion then, and we've already had discussions with the EU through an entity called BEREC, which is a pan-European organization of telecom regulators. I've had this discussion with the communications minister in Mexico, with the communications minister in Israel. I'll continue to have these discussions, and we're now formalizing this as a project of the International Bureau to seek to achieve this goal of internationally harmonized spectrum for M-bands. Next, the FCC will develop and execute a healthcare stakeholder outreach plan to promote greater collaboration between the FCC and the healthcare sector on policies at the intersection of communications and health. And finally, agreeing with a recommendation of the task force, the FCC will recruit a permanent FCC healthcare director, a position that will function as the central point of contact at the FCC to external groups on all health-related issues, and that will own the charge for driving various policies to accelerate mHealth at the FCC. There are other recommendations in the plan. They're all terrific. I've directed our staff to review all of them, to analyze them carefully, and to move forward where we can and where we should. And I'm very much looking forward to working with these three terrific people, the other members of the task force, to put these recommendations into effect and to achieve our goal of accelerating the harnessing of mHealth opportunities. So thank you, most importantly, to the three of you for your great, great work. Thank you to our team at the FCC, Jordan Newstan and others, for driving this from our end. Thank you to our alumni who are here. And Rob, thank you for hosting this and for the work that you're doing to achieve the same goals. Great. Thanks.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your leadership on this issue. And I know we'll be looking forward to seeing real changes and progress in the next few months. So with that, I'll turn it over to Julian. You can do it either from here or here, but maybe here is better. Up to you.
Sure.
Got it.
Thank you. Our plan was to spend a few moments each on comments and then run through slides that would help us provide an overview to some more of the content of the report, although I think Chairman Genachowski did such a good job of covering the content that it's going to facilitate catching everyone up. So there may not be as many questions as we had considered. First of all, a note of thanks to the staff at the FCC, to Chairman Genachowski, and to Jordan and to Maya and others who helped us tremendously. And members of the task force, a number of the members of the task force are here. People have worked tirelessly over the summer months to have teleconferences and other meetings and as was mentioned, to, in a relatively short time, try to gather ideas, think broadly, but with a focus on what could be implemented in a relatively short time frame. I think that a really noteworthy point is that as a result of all the conversations and the meetings, and we covered details on communication technologies, and we covered details on all manner of things that would fit under the umbrella of today's conversation, but in the end, the recommendation that came out is very much about a clinical or healthcare pull as opposed to a technology push. I think that really should, I think that really shows that the group, even while working through the details, realized that in the end, one doesn't really achieve change through a technology push. It has to be through a pathway that really makes a difference in terms of the delivery of healthcare nationally. In addition to that, we moved among different areas of care. There were discussions about mobile as in mobile handsets, and there were discussions about other broadband technologies and rural technology. We'll talk about all of that. But in the end, we also recognize that, of course, healthcare is a system, and one can't really look in isolation at any of these separate parts and expect to achieve a meaningful difference at a national level. And so you'll see in the report that all the different components of the larger system were addressed in a way that we thought could be actionable by the FCC as well as by the community that was represented and involved in the work. So with that, those are just a few of the comments that I wanted to make to move along, and I think continue, and I'll move over to Robert Jarrin.
Thanks, Julian. So really quickly, just I really want to thank the chairman for his leadership in making this happen. It was really his idea to bring together these experts and other stakeholders to discuss what's going on in mobile health. Importantly, I see this as an offshoot of the work begun in the National Broadband Plan, and more importantly, forward-looking to where we can go. It's important to realize that the recommendations that are here are not a litany or a laundry list of things that have been done incorrectly or complaints. This is a very optimistic view of things that can be done that are actionable. And we really wanted to frame things in the way of looking at communications, broadband specifically, with all of the other offsets of communications. There's a lot to deal with. When people talk about wireless or when people talk about broadband, there are a lot of other types of technologies and applications that all fit in there. Licensed spectrum, unlicensed spectrum, wide area network, local area network, there's a lot to deal with. So with that, we really did do as much outreach as we can. Really want to thank the rest of the mHealth Task Force, some of which are here. But there have been a lot of consultations in a very short amount of time, and really want to thank also the two co-chairs. And with that, I'll let Doug.
It's Doug Trauner. So first of all, I want to thank the chairman as well. Not going to spend too much time repeating what's already been said. I think what's been really impressive about the team and the time that we've been able to put this together, again, is that focus not on what the issues are, but what are the opportunities? How can we actually make a difference? What are the pieces that can be addressed? And importantly, healthcare is a system. It is not one agency or one company or one group, but really what are the different pieces? How can the different pieces work together better? There are some great opportunities. Some of them are pretty low-hanging fruit. Some of them are going to take some creative thinking to bring together. The exciting thing is to put together some of the beginning, the first steps for some of that. Some of those pieces are already being worked out. So it is nice to be able to sit down with a great group of people and to start to help drive that forward.
And we can't move our slides.
There's a technology problem here.
There's something wrong with the wireless.
We end up with a wire.
I think it's because there's so many people in here with Bluetooth that's interfering with that. There you go.
Can we flip the slide? There we go.
Next slide. So we do have a few slides that'll walk through at a high level what the issues are and what we're making the recommendations for. As soon as we can get to...
I think the very next slide was actually the overarching goal, if I'm not mistaken, which states, as the chairman said, by 2017, mHealth, wireless health, and e-care solutions will be routinely available as part of best practices for medical care.
And to that point, we went through a process where it was the three of us working, but really it was everyone who attended the mHealth Summit. We did a lot of outreach to other industry participants, agencies. There was some great interaction, great suggestions, people that are actually dealing with the challenges today in terms of, you know, we're trying to drive a particular medical device to market, and we're dealing with, some of them are spectrum issues, some of them are adoption issues, some of them are, you know, what are the real challenges? So we got a great list of ideas, and that was really what the basis for this process was to drive it forward. So.
One of the things that we want folks to appreciate is that in order for this overarching goal to happen, there needs to be not only the leadership and the collaboration by the FCC with other federal agencies, but there are a litany of other things that need to happen, specifically reimbursement and other financial incentives to make these things happen. That's not an FCC problem or issue per se, although with some of the recommendations that we're going to go through, you're going to see that there are overlapping themes where the FCC definitely helps to guide. We want to make sure that, you know, folks appreciate that.
And to that point, in terms of driving the adoption through the financial lane, there is a huge push right now towards certain financial programs that are being driven right now. And you're already seeing, I just want to highlight, that those recommendations, those actions are driving technologies that are driving solutions to market that hospitals are looking to adopt. So by taking that approach, things happen very quickly. So there is some great opportunity along that line.
The slide that's being shown is one meant just to clarify the, some of the terminology, because it, we wrestled with this as a group, and we don't think that we've really finalized anything yet. However, for the sake of this conversation today, we're speaking fairly broadly when we use the term mHealth, and so we just wanted to make that crystal clear, or even more confusing.
And that's actually an issue that we tried to deal with, the nomenclature behind mobile health, wireless health, e-care. E-care was defined in the National Broadband Plan, so we're going to go through that. So, sure, so here are the goals, which I believe everyone has a copy of, and you can also access online. It's on ITIF's website. There are five goals. Under each goal, there are specific action items or recommendations. These are the actual goals for purposes of the presentation. We've actually tried to condense the language and make it a little easier to follow. So with that, we'll go to goal number one.
So in terms of goal one, really it's about, you know, the role the FCC is playing in this space right now. And really the key point here is there are some great opportunities to support other agencies. There's some great opportunities to drive and work and collaborate with industry. We don't see this, we see this as really an opportunity going forward to, you know, how can the FCC work with other agencies and work with industry to move the adoption forward. So with that, there are a series of recommendations.
Four recommendations under FCC should continue to play a leadership role. The first recommendation is to hire a healthcare director, which, as you heard, Chairman Genachowski said they're going to be making steps towards that. The next recommendation is for agencies to improve their educational outreach activities. Again, the chairman mentioned that there are steps being taken to accomplish that. Third, for the FCC to create a healthcare website, which is going to be specific to the FCC's work in wireless health, mobile health, e-care technologies, with links to other agencies and their work and some of the collaborative efforts that are going on between the agencies. And fourth, the continuation of public input, one of which is a recommendation to actually extend the work of this mHealth task force through an external working group with other agencies.
So in terms of the interagency collaboration, again, healthcare is a complicated system, and we don't see that any one agency really has that core responsibility, because, you know, there are issues around, as we talked about, the financial, there are technical implementation, there are standards bodies that are trying to define, you know, approaches to drive innovation forward. So really, key point here is we don't see this as any one agency, and, you know, we look forward to seeing how the different agencies can actually think about it in terms of the end-to-end, what's required to drive, improve healthcare delivery, both from a financial, from a technical standpoint, from a care delivery, from a best practices within healthcare, from a, you know, proven medical standpoint. So again, we see it as many different agencies actually needing to step up to the plate and move, help move this forward.
So the second goal being federal agencies should increase collaboration. The first recommendation is that HHS should convene a working group under Section 618 of the Food Drug Administration Safety and Innovation Act of 2012. Under Section 618, Congress gives the authority and the power to Secretary Sebelius to convene a working group between the FCC, the ONC, and the FDA, amongst other things, to discuss health information technologies, but also give an update on mobile medical applications. They can do this within the next 18 months. We feel that this is a very worthwhile endeavor. It would be a good use of all the agencies to have an open stakeholder discussion, because they're supposed to bring in external stakeholders. So we're hoping that they can leverage some of the work that the mHealth Task Force has done. Under the
Rob,
second...
Can you just... explain the acronyms for folks? Not everybody may know what ONC is.
ONC is the Office of the National Coordinator, the FCC obviously the Federal Communications Commission, and FDA being the Food and Drug Administration. Food and Drug Administration has a big part of mobile health because they actually are the ones that regulate medical devices, and in this case, Converge medical devices. The ONC, as most of you know, is helping to define the rules behind the adoption of health information technologies across America, and they're working hand-in-hand with CMS on CMS's EHR incentive payment program. And then, of course, the Federal Communications Commission with their leadership in communications, specifically in the area of medical radio and broadband. Number two, the second recommendation is for FCC and FDA to continue their collaboration specific to Converge medical devices. As some of you may know, the FCC and the FDA signed a memorandum of understanding a few years ago. They've had extensive work, including a large stakeholder two-day conference. They both have liaisons assigned to each agency to work together. They've had a number of meetings to further things, and the FCC and FDA have actually worked on specific guidance on radio frequencies as well as mobile medical applications. We think that that's a very worthwhile collaboration, and they should continue that collaboration going forward.
I think it would be interesting for a moment to talk a bit about the notion of converged medical devices, and the definition would be helpful. Maybe start with that and then...
Sure. So a converged medical device is a medical device that is a traditional device that deals with diagnosing, treatment, curing in a patient, meaning a human or an animal, and falls under the definition of Section 201H of the Federal Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act. Converged meaning that it not only is a medical device, but it also has some kind of wireless functionality, whether it be a short range radio or wide area network radio, such as cellular.
And as we're sitting here, I was of course listening intently, but also I was looking at the at everyone else sitting in the audience. I'd say about at least 50% of people are tapping away on their smart devices of various kinds. Probably some. How many people are microblogging? I wonder. And so several. And you know, we've integrated these devices into our lives, and yet there's this other side of our lives, which sometimes is pretty relevant, healthcare, that is. And we wonder why we wouldn't be recording our heart tones when we're feeling palpitations and just sending that file to our physicians. And if we have a strange skin bump, lesion, funny-looking rash, why don't we routinely take photos of that, given that our cameras are up to, I don't know how many gazillion megapixels now in the iPhone 7 or whatever just came out. The point is, these things are really, we know that it's not science fiction any longer. And I think that, you know, the idea set forth by the FCC is that are there barriers that we could address? And I think it's actually worthwhile to kind of keep checking in and look at this incredible gap, a chasm between what we're doing everywhere else in our lives, as I'm just sitting and watching. And we could and should be doing this in healthcare, and yet we can't do this with patient information without security. We can't do it without secure messaging. It isn't easy for us to send these files. We don't have a pathway for appropriate for reimbursement that actually can incentivize groups to do this kind of work. And so there are all these little gaps along the way, and of course we're going to keep talking about that, and my intent was not to set us off in a different direction, but I had to look at everyone and see that we're living in two different worlds. We're living a healthcare needs and gap world, which we're not resolving, and then we're living another world with technology, and everyone is sitting here taking advantage of it. Streaming web presence, recording, wireless everywhere, microblogging, and so forth. So.
And yet less than 20% of patients can email with their physician, message with their physician. And
yes.
Very few physicians in this country can even send a message to another physician who's not in the same medical group. So,
exactly.
You know, we're dealing with a complete disconnect. Today, faxes is still the predominant method of communication between doctors' offices. So,
so not just some lofty, esoteric conversation here, but, you know, one that's really has an immediate problem with hopefully near-term resolution. And I'm really excited the information we just received today and was just presented by the chairman in terms of the next steps, I think is taking us in the right direction to address these. So sorry about that commercial introduction, but watching everyone while you were speaking, I wanted to go there for a moment.
Thank you, Julian. Okay, so the third recommendation under this goal is for the FCC, the ONC, and CMS to really have a deeper collaborative effort, specifically behind the Electronic Health Records Incentive Payment Program that's being rolled out by CMS. In meaningful use, stage two of the final rule that just came out, there actually is a stage two objective on health outcomes to engage patients and their families and their care. There are two requirements under that stage two objective. One is to allow unique patients to be able to view online, download, and transmit health information within 4 days of the info being available to an eligible provider. The second aspect is to allow 5% of unique patients seen by the eligible provider to view, download, transmit to a third party their health information. There is, however, an exclusion. And the exclusion is that any eligible provider that conducts 50% or more of their patient encounters in any county that does not have 50% or more of its housing with 3 megabits broadband availability may exclude the second part of what I just explained, the part about transmitting to a third party their health information. They base that on information from the FCC. We know that the FCC and CMS and ONC are in collaboration and consultation, but we think that it can go a little deeper and it can be a little more transparent, and that actually the FCC should take part of some of the ONC's FACA meetings and briefings that they've been having to try to really leverage knowledge. The FCC's expertise in this area, I think, would be really vitally important. So that's an area that we think that there could be a good collaboration. The fourth one is for the FCC and CMS to directly share data and collaborate in a much broader, more general way, because there are obviously things that the CMS are trying to do in rural areas, some of which are being considered under the CMMI, the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation, specific to rural areas. Again, the FCC's expertise can be leveraged there, and by doing so, by sharing data, they can even possibly come up with new ways of one, reaching connectivity to those areas that are hard to reach in the U.S., but then secondly, hopefully the CMMI would consider incentivizing things like mHealth, eCare, and wireless health solutions. The fifth recommendation is to standardize health technology nomenclature. Going back to the aspect of what is the definition, when relating policy and trying to define policy, if one agency defines something and has a different context than the other, it can become very troublesome and problematic in trying to reach policy goals and outcomes.
Well,
so we think that that's an area.
And specifically on that point, from the beginning of this process, we had, I cannot tell you how many conversations just about the question of what is mHealth? Is mHealth even the right term? And that's just one. And we sat down today, we were starting having another conversation. 10 minutes of a 20-minute conversation was around the nomenclature. So not that that's necessarily the most exciting conversation to have, but it's wasting a lot of discussions and a lot of time across. I mean, if those conversations are happening here, they're happening at every meeting where these issues are coming up. So that's the issue we're driving. To adding one point of specificity around the data sharing question, the issue around where ONC is establishing the rules, there's actually a great opportunity. The FCC has a map of broadband penetration and information about that. In the sharing model, there's a great opportunity for the FCC to actually then see what are people reporting from the field and saying, in our community, we actually are reporting it as this, and we're applying for an exemption because it isn't meeting the 3 megabits penetration. So great opportunity to be sharing that information, looking at the map, but also potentially identifying those applicants that maybe there is sufficient bandwidth, but they're just not aware of it, or they may be going after other financial incentives. So, we do see that sharing, great opportunity on that one specifically.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think I missed one of the recommendations. Number five is explore sharing health data between agencies. There are other agencies that have data specific to healthcare, and I think that's a point that Doug was making right now. And there needs to be some more collaboration there that could be very useful. And very finally, the seventh one is to provide expertise on secure health messaging.
I touched on that briefly. I mean, the real issue there is today in the country, you know, what we're able to do from a communication standpoint within healthcare. There is messaging within organizations, very small penetration of patients can communicate with their physicians. Very few physicians can communicate to other physicians outside of their medical group, outside of their hospital, outside of their organization. That level of communication, as a country, we just need to raise that bar on that. The level of innovation that's going to come from being able to do that, we see as astronomical. You look at the number of ways that just email in this country has changed the way we all do business, the ability to to share and communicate. We see the same possibility for healthcare, but core communication capabilities need to be enabled.
Third goal of the task force is that the FCC should expand broadband access for healthcare, really targeted towards two of their programs, one being the rural healthcare pilot program, which is now concluded, and also modernizing the Lifeline program for broadband. As you heard the chairman mention, that they are taking steps towards modernizing the rural healthcare pilot program for a more permanent program. We're hoping that as part of that, they expand awareness to help rural providers understand what is available, rural healthcare providers, and also explore wireless technology in those offerings. And secondly, to permit this idea of consortium applications to streamline a way for applicants to really be able to pull together their resources and be able to get the most attractive offerings that they can. And then secondly, modernizing the Lifeline program for broadband.
Yeah, from a Lifeline standpoint, we see an incredible, there's definitely an overlap. You're dealing with a low-income population that are eligible to receive certain types of support to have telecommunication services. At the same time, those same populations of people are being discharged from the hospital with conditions, with needs to be able to communicate better with their physicians post-discharge. So when you think about the initiatives to reduce readmissions, post-discharge readmissions, there's a great question you should be being asked at that point. Are you able to communicate with your physician at that point? What tools can we be putting in your hand at that point when you're being discharged to enable you to communicate back with your physician so you don't have to come back into the ER room? Those are the kinds of things that we see bringing that communication, that question, to help bring the Lifeline working closer with CMS to try and figure out how to make that happen.
One of the things that we saw as a natural linkage between Lifeline and CMS is that one of the criteria that Lifeline uses for applicants to be able to actually be in the program is Medicaid participation. So what we're envisioning is that as they move to hopefully support fixed and mobile broadband, that they can also integrate some of those services that are specific to mobile health, e-care, and wireless health that other agencies related to CMS are working on, for example, HRSA, and then integrate healthcare delivery through the Lifeline program itself. There's a good area of nexus and collaboration there. Fourth goal, continuing efforts on capacity, reliability, interoperability, and RF safety. Quite frankly, mobile broadband spectrum is the backbone and the lifeblood for wide area network solutions. The backbone and the lifeblood of the backbone. It's a finite natural resource, as I know many of you can appreciate. In America alone, there are 331 million mobile subscribers to date. That's 104% penetration. As more and more people and more devices come online, spectrum will become even a bigger scarcity, especially as they go into more robust applications, which I'll defer to Julian to speak about. And really, you heard the chairman mention the second recommendation is international harmonization of med radio spectrum, which they're taking steps to do. He said that they've been speaking to regulators in Europe, Mexico, and Israel. But I'll defer to Julian on 3 and 4.
104% penetration. Interesting way to calculate penetration. I would think once you've penetrated, it doesn't work that way.
No.
Yeah.
I've got two phones, so there you go.
I've got four.
I'll see you too.
I want to know about your plan.
Anybody with five?
I saw a nod or two, actually.
It's funny that you mentioned the number of phones people have, and then in the other pocket you have a Bluetooth earpiece, and your laptop has Wi-Fi, and that, so on. And that's actually a big part of the problem. that was discussed within our group, which is the notion of wireless spectrum device coexistence and interference, and how does one assess that and predict it. In our lab in Cambridge, we have a medical device interoperability lab, and we set up a really slick demo. You know what happens when you set up a demo, right? So we set up a really slick demo, which we used a location tracking technology. Some people call it the RFID, but there's a host of technologies. And we set up location tracking technology within our lab in order to track, in a simulated environment, a clinician going to different care areas within the hospital. And then we tied that into other information so that we could have a smarter system to identify if a patient is in trouble, is there a caregiver nearby? And the demo, you know, was, I would say, as I said, it was really slick. It was very cool. And then we had a group of people come into the lab to watch the demo. People with 5 phones, people with 6 phones, people, I don't know what they had on there, little transmitters hidden away. The point is that it didn't work at all when the room was filled with a crowd that was there to see what could be an approach that could markedly improve patient safety by improving the quality of alarms and by tracking caregivers and knowing if they could respond to a patient that's in trouble. And so the problem that we face in many healthcare environments, this is certainly true in the hospital, and it's true in many other, and will be more true in other environments, undoubtedly, are problems with assessing and planning for the spectrum and the devices to function as they were intended, especially medical devices that are intended to transmit alarms, transmit waveforms, provide alerts, and so forth. This is a vexing problem. It's a vexing problem for healthcare delivery organizations today. Remember, when you look at a wireless device, you don't just look at the devices that might be in the room next to you, but the devices that are in the floors upstairs and downstairs and behind you and all the adjacent rooms are all relevant. If we start to have hundreds or thousands of infusion pumps and mobile devices and so forth in hospitals, we are setting ourselves up for problems that are quite hard to plan for. So the example we had in our lab fortunately didn't result in anything other than embarrassment, but also an opportunity to learn, and now we're using that to have a better sense of how to plan appropriately. And that really provides a real-world example of the kind of problems that hopefully the wireless testbed plan of the FCC will help us with. Now, initially, going back a few years, the wireless testbed notion for the FCC has been one of access to licensed spectrum to make it easier for organizations and companies to develop and test devices and get access to spectrum that normally would not be accessible to them. But that idea has matured significantly over the last few years, and especially within the task force, into being more complete. And so looking at, for example, the test and development domain, and how could there possibly be tools that are available to facilitate, especially by smaller companies that don't have the resources to comprehensive wireless test environments. How could they have access to tools and national centers? For healthcare delivery organizations such as ours, we don't have an easy means to talk to the providers of technology and ascertain whether they meet the requirements that would be appropriate in a healthcare delivery organization, because we don't know what requirements are appropriate. There aren't clear-cut guidelines, there aren't well-adopted standards, there aren't readily available public testing tools. And so a number of these things are detailed in depth in the report, in this section, especially in goal number 4. So a big part of that has been the wireless testbed. In the report, in the information, we also received some expert advice from the FDA in this area, because the FDA also needs additional tools that would facilitate testing and evaluation. And you know, that's not something that I can speak for officially in that capacity for the FDA's needs, but clearly the FDA saw the relationship with FCC as being instrumental in understanding some of the technology and requirements. The other thing that we addressed in the report was the notion of having adequate bandwidth for image transmission for images such as PET scan, CT, MRI, and so forth. And it was actually just at the beginning of this report period when I was providing telephone consultation to my family members. That's a typical part of being a physician. And my 87-year-old mother I wasn't supposed to say her age. Sorry, Mom. My 29-plus mother had to find her way to a local hospital in Brooklyn to pick up her discs, go to FedEx, and send them to a hospital in Manhattan. It was her first time in a FedEx office. And it wasn't an easy thing for her to do. And after sending them that way, the images got lost. They were delivered because, you know, it depends if something goes through the mail room or through FedEx. Didn't get to the right office. A week later, they were finally discovered in the hospital. And this was a fairly urgent need that those images be reviewed. So as part of our due diligence with the group, we've learned that organizations around the country, certainly Partners Healthcare, Mayo Clinic, many other organizations, are now receiving patients with discs, stack of discs. They're importing hundreds of thousands of these images per year into their system. There is no easy way to perform the transmission from institution to institution. Now, and the American College of Radiology has spent considerable time and effort thinking about this and has recommendations on their website, and they provided them as part of meaningful use guide information for the ONC. So as part of our recommendations, we've addressed some of these things and some of these needs and proposed that some of these needs be studied. Now, from the FCC standpoint, that might be bandwidth requirements. It might be, you know, are all hospitals capable of doing this from an infrastructure standpoint, or nationally, or cities at the city level, whatever it might be. We're really not focusing on for example, the standards necessary for that. Although they're important, we don't think they're within the purview of the FCC per se. So those are some of the highlights from goal number four, and there's a lot more content within the document itself. Do you want to add anything?
Yeah, I'll just finish off. Recommendation number five is to ease the specific absorption rate testing requirements for intermittent data transfer. And then lastly, the FCC should evaluate simplifying the installation of telehealth devices in home environments. Moving on to goal number five, I'll defer to.
So from an industry standpoint, there's incredible interest right now. And you can go take a look at the number of mobile health apps that have been developed, many of which are available for free. So there's huge drive from a development standpoint of applications. There's a growing amount of investment taking place in healthcare IT today that wasn't taking place 2, 3, 4 years ago. A lot of that interest has taken place because of the Patient Protection Act, High Tech Act. There are regulatory changes that people are seeing. There's an opportunity that maybe can turn, you know, healthcare around. How, you know, they're going to have to turn and start to recognize and realize business models that are going to be successful around that. There are still questions that a lot of investors and businesses are trying to figure those models out. Goes back to the question we were talking about earlier, you know, is there a financial model? The readmission reduction activity has definitely shown that people will develop technologies and will implement those technologies around when there's a financial component. The other part of it, it also relates to the access to data. If solutions are being built today in the market, industry has a responsibility to also make that data available securely, you know, control, you know, with access, you know, control all of the technologies to support that, but that the information needs to be able to flow from one organization to the next, from one device to the next organization, and to control that. So there's a component to that, and those should be using standard technologies to do that, not proprietary, you know, in-house types of services. So, you know, as a final point, you know, industry is very eager to work with industry as well as with the federal government to move this forward. I think this task force has been a good example, and I know that other agencies are doing similar types of activities. So really, you know, soliciting from industry, what can we do better? You're going to hear some things that are positive, and you're going to hear some things that might not be what you want to hear, but that will help move forward with the adoption. So those are sort of, you know, what industry can do better. Obviously, there's more, but you know, those are sort of the key points that we've highlighted.
If I can, how many folks here are from the task force have been? Great. Well, thank you very much for being here and for being on the task force. A lot more who aren't here that were involved in working hard. We thank them as well.
So great. So thank you so much. Well, I want to open it up for you all in just a minute. But before I do that, I just want to ask a couple questions and say one thing. One is, I'm constantly struck in the United States with how bad our technology is. constantly struck.
We shut ours off.
Yeah, I wasn't sure if that worked.
There you go.
All right. With, you know, how great our... Why don't
we hand one of these to Rob?
Rob?
We can share.
I'm really struck by how great our technology is and you know, how great our companies are and how backwards we are when it comes to applying this technology to this industry. There's a report we did a couple of years ago called Explaining International IT Application Leadership, Health IT, that my colleague Daniel Castro wrote. And we looked around the world at who's leading in health IT in the world and why. And who's leading is a pretty easy, short answer. It's called Scandinavia. And the answer is why is because they want to. I'm oversimplifying vastly, but you mentioned 20% of docs you can email to. In those countries, it's more like 90%. That was 2.5 years ago. So these countries have had conscious strategies. It's certainly easier to coordinate everybody together. But I'm just constantly amazed how that we haven't made more progress, and I know it's sort of the beginning to have it. But my here question, I hear this all the time, that, you know, we need secure email standards. And let me just suggest, in a kind of naive question, why? I don't recall anybody ever, I mean, the millions of emails it seems like I do every day, I don't recall anybody ever hacking into them and reading an email, nor do I have we have a system where if I want to send my brother-in-law an email about my health that I have to have a secure email to him, but to my doctor I do, and to me it's what's the difference. Aren't we setting ourselves up with just like hyper privacy conscious concerns that are really holding back just what could be normal interoperability with communications? But feel free to tell me I don't know what I'm talking about, but it seems to me that that could be a problem.
I think there's two parts to that. One, your question is the security actually necessary, is one. And the second question is, if the security is necessary, why does it have to be so difficult?
Yeah.
I think most people are not aware that when you're at the airport and you're using a not secure email, that actually frequently your username and password is being sent over an unencrypted connection. And if anybody wants to, you can go to an airport and listen to those passwords. If you make that available in healthcare, I think there are broader concerns about that. So if society wants to say that's acceptable, but we as a society here have said that's probably not something that people are going to be comfortable with. So the next question then becomes, does security have to be so difficult? And the short answer to that is no, it doesn't have to be so difficult. There are many, you know, if you look at the banking industry today, they do secure transactions. They've adopted it. You can go to an ATM. You can go anywhere you want, and you can do your banking, and it works. Does it have to be so difficult in healthcare? And the short answer is, no, it doesn't. There are standards that are out there today. ONC has put together a framework called Direct Connect for using existing technology for doing secure communication, and it can be adopted and rolled out. There are questions about, you know, so yes, it can be rolled out. Why have we not done it? I think it goes back to your question about priorities.
Well, also there are differences in as a patient, what you choose to disclose is one matter. And as a healthcare delivery organization, what you are required to protect is another matter. So that has to enter into the conversation. If anything, the need for security we know is increasing, and the awareness of security is increasing. And the problem has been that security implementation has been too burdensome. It's becoming less burdensome, a little bit more seamless, but it's not uncommon today that computers, especially laptops and handheld devices that are used for healthcare communication that are issued or used by healthcare delivery organizations must be secured, and the disks, for example, must be encrypted. Now, having heard story after story of people complaining bitterly about how they lost their data after their disk was encrypted and then being told that they should have, quote, backed it up, you know what kind of conversation that's like. Not very pleasant. So on the one hand, we have, I think, come a long way towards more seamless implementation of security, but it's really been only recently that it's been relatively seamless, and it still does add a burden. And part of our national conversation has to be about what is the acceptable burden, and how does that relate to the ease of access and use and the cost of implementation.
Yeah, look, I just think when we do HIPAA and we all feel better, and it's very unclear whether HIPAA has had, you know, any benefits to society other than an enormous amount of costs. And it seems to me we're in the same position here. I can email my doctor just using my email, and I can tell him or her sensitive information. That's in the clear, although email's very encrypted. Shouldn't that be part of the conversation? You mentioned, you know, we need better security on them. But that's true for the entire system. We need better security overall. Why are we singling out healthcare as a sort of special burden?
Well, Rob, let's deconstruct what you just said. So you email your doctor. How do you know that your doctor did not leave his laptop in an area that someone else can come over and read that email? You don't have that protection as a patient. Let's say that you have some kind of a illness or disease condition that is, you know, socially unacceptable. Do you want that kind of information out in the open? That's where a breach happens. That's the reason why HIPAA exists. I'm not necessarily defending every aspect of HIPAA. I think it's the best thing that we've got, given the rules that, you know, they tried to formulate. And I also would like to say that I think that the healthcare industry or the technology industry that's coming into healthcare may not understand HIPAA as you know, there's a lot of misinformation that's being said about HIPAA, whether or not it even applies in certain instances. But if HIPAA doesn't apply, then you're probably going to have a state statute that does apply, you know, that controls basically is the access to that information. Third-party breaches are what they're trying to avoid. They want to make sure that the people who, you know, who are in this chain of custody of information, meaning the patient and the physician or the eligible provider, if you want to call them that, the hospital, the healthcare worker, those are the ones that should only be in contact with that patient's information. If you look at the Office of Civil Rights statistics on breaches from last year, if I can recall correctly, I think 4% or less were actually the ones that were technology breaches, and they all happened in-house, meaning people did have passwords that they shouldn't have had passwords to go in and look at people's information. It wasn't so many hackers going in and trying to take and steal and so forth. I'm not saying that that can't happen. I think it most certainly can happen. But a lot of the breaches, that 96%, however many numbers, I don't have the report in front of me, were breaches because people were careless with information. They leave disks in a car, the car gets broken into, then suddenly 500,000 patients' information is out on the streets. There needs to be a protection for that because you have to make sure that if, in fact, a third party gets that information, then you have to, you know, give a notification, you have to tell the world, you have to notify OCR, and that's really the intent of that statute. You know, from a practical perspective, I'm with you. You know, I should be allowed just to email my doctor, and it shouldn't be such a hard thing to do, but we really need to have safeguards because it is very sensitive information. You know, it may not be for all of you, it may not be for yourself.
Right. Well, no, I of course, that's all. We should move on, but I just would point out, to me, I think this is an area where there needs to be a lot more work because there's just so many sort of, we all know, assumptions in here that I think we don't all know.
That's right.
Many of the things you said, we regulate in other ways and in different types.
When I found myself in an ambulance a few years ago on the receiving end of healthcare, I lay there with my phone sending text messages to family members, and I really wasn't overly concerned about whether they were secure or not. Right.
Exactly.
At that point,
and
getting information timely.
Thankfully, you could do that. You weren't prohibited by law from sending a text message.
That's true, and although, in fact, the ambulance drivers, the EMTs could easily have stopped me about concerns of interference with their medical equipment.
Well, that's one of the questions then opened up. The FDA, you both talked about that, you all talked about this, the chairman talked about this, an FDA-FCC partnership around converged devices. And I think, Robert, your example was convergence coming from a medical device into the wireless space, and then we also have convergence coming the other way. And the concern would be that somehow we're going to end up, and by the way, I'm not saying this is true, I'm just saying this is the concern that we've heard, that we're going to end up regulating the iPad because it has the capability of doing some sort of health IT thing. Or we'll regulate cell phones themselves because they have the capability. How do we avoid moving this regulatory system over into stuff that really shouldn't be regulated and really keep it narrowly focused on the things that should be?
I'm sure we'll all have an opinion on this.
Exactly. I was going to say we're all pretty much involved in this. Because you singled me out, I guess I'll begin. I think that on its face, the statute is as clear as mud, but it actually is very clear, and I'm talking about the definition of a medical device, Section 201H, which basically stipulates that a thing, anything, it could be a medical device if the intended use is to be used in the diagnosis, the care, the treatment, the prevention of a disease, a condition, in a man or an animal, and there are a lot of words that I'm leaving out. And that's also with regards to a component or an accessory. What the statute, what Congress, what the FDA are trying to get at is that if you promote your device publicly in any way as if though it were intended for health, then you fall under the definition. Traditional device manufacturers, I think, really have a concrete understanding of what that is. Now we're going into this wonderful marriage, convergence of science, technology, communications, and so many people that are not traditional developers of these types of devices are coming into this space that they may make something and think this is just a health app. But unfortunately, because of what they state about that health app actually brings them under the definition of a medical device. So that's where there is some lack of clarity. Where it gets even more ambiguous, to them at least, where it gets more ambiguous is the notion of accessories between devices. Typically, if there's a medical device and it's working with another device, and that device has the intent of working with that medical device, then the parent device, whatever classification it has, that subservient device ends up getting assigned that classification as well.
Let me take a specific example. Let's say there's, mm-hmm. I'm just making this up. There's an iPad stethoscope application. And so And you stick it into the iPad, and it does something, and it records it on the iPad, and then it sends it wirelessly to something else. Does Apple now need to start worrying that iPads themselves get regulated?
So the FDA today is saying that the company making the, in fact, there's a nice little application for your iPhone where you can hold the sensors on the back, it'll take your EKG, and you can send that to your doctor. They're asking those types of services to go through a process.
The sensor part, not the device part.
Where it starts to become an interesting question is take a blood pressure cuff that you can plug into an iPhone or maybe even an Android phone, and you start to run into some of the questions of which version of the operating system, then there are upgrades that occur. So there are some questions the FDA to date is still not going down that path. Mm-hmm. But there are some real questions about some of the use cases where that could be problematic. Yeah,
Julian's about to bite his tongue off. I just want to insert myself in here for 2 seconds.
It is.
Heavily. In this example that we have here, the burden is actually on that medical device that's using the iPhone. It can be the iPhone, it can be a common computer, it can be anything that gives it connectivity. When that device company that makes an obvious medical device brings it to the FDA, they're going to ask for clearance or approval based on that connectivity. They're going to say, this can be connected into a commercial device. The device itself, Apple isn't running around saying, hey, I am now a stethoscope. Apple's intended use for that device is to be a pad, an iPad, to process information and send it. So there's a very small distinction in there that's really important for people to understand. Where it gets murky is when an iPad, or let's say Steve Jobs, rest in peace, was on a stage holding a waveform saying this is what it can be used for. That's when they're actually making a claim about that iPad, because someone can intend that to be, oh, it's a medical device now, not thinking the software that's being run on the iPad is the medical device. And that's where there is some lack of clarity. And hopefully the FDA is going to get to that with the mobile medical apps guidance document. Julian, please.
That's fine. A conversation like this is not infrequently goes down the pathway of the regulations, the statutes, the interpretation. How do we make sure that that Apple, isn't considered a medical device, because that would somehow be a terrible thing and complicate life and so forth. But in reality, I think trying to make that clean distinction, even though we have to from a regulatory standpoint, introduces new problems. Because when we're looking at data that's transmitted end to end from a patient all the way through mobile device into the EHR, for example, if there are problems with that transmission, if the blood pressure, if the values are are corrupted, if there's a data transformation error, if there's a patient ID related issue and so forth, these could have real repercussions. Now, some of these things are just can be handled the equivalent of through Microsoft Excel or through back office software convergent calculations and so forth. But the fact is that what really matters is whether that patient data is either as accurate as you need it to be or delivered in the time frame that you need it to be and so forth. And so on the one hand, we have to make sure that we don't complicate things from a regulatory standpoint, but on the other end, we have to look at what we're really trying to accomplish. So for example, it was only, I think, about a week ago that a physician was working overnight in the pediatric ICU, an attending physician, and his voice over IP, advanced new technology voice over IP phone that sends patient alarm data and waveform data and is the latest kind of converged technology, the battery lasted, maybe 3 or 4 hours. Because in the real world environment we know that our cell phones don't last very long when they have a weak signal, for example, and the phone cranks up the power in order to connect, battery life goes down. Or the example that I gave in my lab where we couldn't communicate as intended and we couldn't perform that, the location system failed. These are real world problems. So if we start to separate the application as the medical device and the host platform as the non-medical device, that looks nice and clean and tidy. But the bottom line is if everyone's voice over IP phone fails when you need it for, that's your only alarm system, for example, we're going to have patient-related safety problems. So I like the idea of thinking about the problem cleanly, but I think we're losing something if we don't also think about the entire system end-to-end and what we needed to accomplish. So
I don't think I would agree with that statement because... Why don't we then regulate the electricity system too? Because if there's an electrical outage,
we do.
No, we don't. Not in that way. We certainly don't. Not in terms of reliability. Were you living in Washington 2 months ago?
We regulate
it at all.
In healthcare, in critical environments, we. Regulate
no, I'm not talking. I'm talking about the doctor who goes home to use the broadband. My only point is, there has to be a line, because if you start to cross the line, then you bring in a regulatory system to the entire device, software, and communications industry and say, all of what you're doing now has to live up to this standard, which means, as far as I can tell, Skype would not be in business, because there's no way Skype could handle any sort of rule like that. I mean, Skype is best efforts internet. Which, by the way, raises another question. You would immediately have to institute some sort of rules around bit differentiation, because not all bits can be treated equal in that kind of network environment.
Well, I mean, don't put words in my mouth. I didn't talk about a class of regulation. I didn't talk about the requirements. All I'm saying is that one has to consider these factors. And so if your expectation of your system is to perform at a certain level, you have to think about all the parts of the system. And you can't just wear blinders and say, well, this application is the medical device and it doesn't matter what platform it's going to run on. It does matter. And the way that's being handled today is it's up to the manufacturer of the application to specify which platform is appropriate. And that might be the right solution. I'm not saying it isn't. I'm just saying we have to be careful or thoughtful about trying to segregate these parts of the system.
I think another example.
They fail.
Talking about, though, also is the question that's been coming up a lot lately around security. So you've got a pacemaker or a real-time glucose monitoring device and the ability to hack into those systems. And the question I think you're somewhat asking is that the market going to create the solutions that have to be tested and they're going to take the ownership of that, or does that have to be regulated? Is that something that the FDA is going to then have to say, you have to use this security standard? Who's owning that security question right now is a question. And you can choose to let industry and say, we've created a means to validate and to ensure that this medical device is secure. And we're going to, that's the process that we've done. And so the device has got the technical requirements and the market can define it. Or you can say the FDA needs to regulate that, which it's not doing today. So it's the same question, I think, you're asking.
Yeah, no, we should, this is a great, this really, these are exactly the kind of
issues. We can always ask about Cruel Patel.
Right. I want to actually open. Do you have a quick thing you want to say before I open it up to everybody? Okay. Pardon me?
I'm good, thanks.
Okay. If you can identify yourself first and...
Yeah, I'm Deborah Runkle from the American Association for the Advancement of Science, AAAS. The biggest issue in health, arguably, today is cost. And it seems as though in the past decades, every great innovation, advanced drugs, advanced surgery, better imaging devices, have probably added to the cost and not reduced the cost of medical care. What do you predict for your mHealth applications? Is it just another thing that's going to get more expensive with perhaps only marginal benefits? You can skip the second clause if you want to, but I'm interested in the cost.
You want to go first, or you want
to? It would be a benefit to you if it got more expensive. Oh, sorry.
I'm going to try to answer this from a practical perspective. I went to go see a doctor last week, and I was kind of excited because I thought that it's one of my doctors, and I thought that they were very modern. And they said, "Yeah, when you come in a little earlier because we want you to fill out some things that are going to go into our new system."
That happened to me this morning.
That's great. So I was excited because I thought that this was going to be I'm going to be writing on some kind of special. Paper, a syntax paper, which then can be read into a machine and then feeds an electronic health record. And when I walked in, what did I find? The old wall filled with manila folders, and then a new wall filled with brand new manila folders. And I was like, are you kidding me? And they said, no. And I'm like, get with the times. Aren't you guys going to electronic health records? You know, it's actually something that you have to do at some point. They said, no, not us, not yet.
Well, my doctor was having me fill out paper that they could put into their electronic health system.
Yeah.
Instead
that's what
of giving
I was
me a computer
for. Right.
To do it myself.
I was hoping for that, only, I think that's it's better. It's not fully there yet. My point being that as we automate healthcare, which is $2.4 trillion worth of our economy, as we get rid of things like paper and things like, collapsing the time, the distance, the space between actually having to go in and see a doctor, as opposed to being able to do a consultation from another area. I honestly feel like it's going to make such a huge change in the amount of money that's wasted in this country. Some of the statistics that we were using, one from the the Institute of Medicine, spoke about how much, $750 billion approximately, that's wasted in healthcare per year. I don't think that health IT is a panacea for all costs. But I think it most certainly is going to help. It's just an obvious thing to me. But part of the solution are updating policies and regulations that have been on the books for years. This aspect of reimbursement and financial incentives is a really big deal. And unless things start changing, it's not going to. I'm elated to see that in the proposed 2013 physician fee schedule, there is some language in there on, and I got to look at this, post-discharge transitional care, rather, that's not face-to-face within the 30-day discharge for an inpatient is being considered for an HCPCS code. One-time payment, but that's a big deal. That's a huge change. That really does go to the core of remote patient monitoring. I read on a blog the other day, MobiHealth News, there was an article on Medicare, and I believe it was Chris Wasden from PricewaterhouseCoopers. He said, the more that I look at what remote patient monitoring, what mHealth, what these things can do, I'm beginning to feel as if, though, it would be malpractice not to use them. Because, you can eliminate the amount of time people spend in a healthcare facility. When they come out and you can remotely monitor them, it really can help to avoid getting them back in, the whole aspect of readmission rates. I can't help but to think that that's going to change that $2.4 trillion price tag.
Yeah, I'm going to let him go on because I...
So, I think there are two parts to it. One is, you're right, it's a new technology, there's new capabilities, but it comes back to, on a personal level, so I'm a Kaiser member, and they've done a fabulous job of implementing medical records, and I can email to my physicians, and I know it's their secure messaging. You can send a picture of a spider bite, and have a discussion with your doctor, do I need to go in, is this something I need to worry about? It saves you time, It saves them time. It's 5 minutes, and there can be an assessment on the phone. So that example there, the incentives are aligned because they're not reimbursed for that office visit. Okay? So if you look at that one example, it makes a lot of sense. It makes sense for the physician. It makes sense for the patient. It's convenient. I didn't have to take time off from work. So that example, pretty easy to say, this saved everybody money. Okay?
I'm going to argue with that. Because if it's so easy for me, aren't I going to start communicating
more often? I want to actually open
it
up for
And that's the next question.
I don't want to have a dialogue on just on this one point. So if there are other folks have questions, why don't we just jump in?
If I may, I want to introduce two points that, as a start, as a jumping off point, but I think it's broader because the notion of leveraging communication technologies and health IT is similar to the notion of preventive medicine. Now, preventive medicine could cost more and preventive medicine could cost less. But we know that intervention at the right phase in healthcare is the right thing to do, because it reduces suffering, it improves the quality of life, and it's a more efficient way to take care of patients. The other thing that we know that technology can do and has done in every other domain is automation. There are some things that technology does much better than we do. Remembering things, looking for skipped steps in the process, things of that nature. And until we have a system in place that's reliable, that's complete, we can't do those things. And I think the real benefits that we're talking about in terms of the next phase of healthcare is the idea that we could start to automate things that should be automated, freeing people up to spend the time on the things that they should be spending time on as individuals, as human beings, and improving the quality of preventive care by leveraging technology. The other huge piece that's going to change is the idea, and you know, our discussion about apps notwithstanding, I think that that is the next big phase of healthcare. It has to do with knowledge capture, it capturing expertise of clinicians, of healthcare workers in various domains, and then applying them to subsets of patients. You know, really the epitome of personalized medicine. And again, we need the technology infrastructure to do that. So costing more, costing less, and you know, we can work with these discussions and analyses, but I think ultimately those are the real benefits to be gained by the changes in technology such as the one we're talking about today with mHealth.
Other questions? Yes.
Hi, I'm Katie Visner, Senior Policy Researcher for the American Foundation for the Blind. I'm filling in today for Mark Reichert, who wishes he could be here. But one thing that I hear throughout this, and when I'm listening to you talk about all these possibilities for moving forward, this seems like, you know, we have the potential to improve healthcare so much for so many disabled people, but also thinking about particularly the accessibility issues for groups like the blind and visually impaired. We already know that there's so many problems with them even being able to read glucose meters or being able to have web accessibility to go and look at that insurance website, which we find a lot of problems with. And their doctors just say, oh, go and look this up. But they can't. So what kind of measures are being taken to at least improve on this universal accessibility? And also, just in terms of broadband adoption, a lot of times, a lot of people don't even know, they don't even have a way to go and get that set up for themselves. So what kinds of measures are being taken for them?
Robert.
Want me to go?
Sure. You're a universal go-to.
The universal go-to guy. I think accessibility has always been an issue and will continue to be so, unfortunately. It's hard for me to answer this question because on one side I see a lot of strides that have been taken by, you know, even popular operating systems where they claim, you know, this is the accessibility part of the app that you can go to, and apparently that helps. I am not disabled, so I normally don't go to that part of the app to see what it actually does. And when I speak to folks like yourself who tell me, you know, it actually doesn't work well, it's very hard to get to, there's a form factor issue, there's, you know, humans factor testing that obviously they haven't done, it's a problem. I think that it's something that, you know, there is room for improvement. I think that they have taken strides to do better, you know, but that's part of what we're trying to do is bring the right stakeholders to this conversation, and part of the reason why the mHealth Task Force came to being. You know, I really recommend that you meet with me afterwards so I can get your information, see how I can get you involved in this and other efforts, because I think that it's an important part of what we're trying to do.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Hi, David Collins. Excuse me, David Collins, Senior Director of MHIMS. Wanted to commend everybody on the report. Excellent. I mean, it's just concise, it's needed, good information. I love the alignment with other agencies where we're going with meaningful use. This is kind of a wide open question. I was just interested, so out of this report, what's the number one priority? What's the number one barrier? What's the number one low-hanging fruit?
Start with the barrier.
What, you want to go down the line, or yeah, why don't we do it that way?
Just going to comment that we boil down, you know, an unbelievable number of issues down to five. There comes a point where, you know, you could distill things down only so far.
Well, they're all pretty.
How much content is this?
Right.
Got to do one.
Well, my priority is to pass the buck.
That's perfect. I'll take it. The most important thing to me is more mobile broadband spectrum. It really is a lifeblood of the backbone. That to me is the biggest priority. The biggest obstacle is reimbursement. It was hard for us to lump in reimbursement directly into this kind of a report because it deals with the FCC, and the area of oversight that the FCC has is not the area of reimbursement. However, there are many areas of overlap of work that the FCC does, and obviously CMS depends on some of that work. You know, to build in an exclusion given broadband availability in an area is a big deal, and they you know, they framed it in a way that they report on the FCC. I know that they have some kind of a conversation, communication between the two agencies, but there needs to be more of that because I think they could have gone a lot further, and that information sharing is actually important for the FCC itself to know exactly where they're not, you know, reaching the hard-to-reach places. You know, hopefully in the future, wireless is going to be a big part of that conversation. So those are the ones for me.
I would throw out the non-agent.
What's that third one?
Do you want to?
Low-hanging fruit.
Low-hanging fruit.
Definitely one through four. The first goal, meaning that the FCC should continue its leadership in this area. Hire the healthcare director, make the website, do more interagency collaboration. You know, and I think that it suffice it to say that the chairman jumped on those immediately, and they've already taken steps towards accomplishing that. I think that that's great.
I'll
give the one, and the one I think is the overarching goal. This can't be a technology push. This has to be about improving the quality of healthcare. And if we keep that in our lens the entire time, we're likely to be more successful. And you know, you saw that as hard as we tried through the task force to obtain relatively broad input, we still missed a number of important areas. So it's a challenge to do that, and we have to look at the entire system. And without doing that, we'll waste our time on little tiny pieces that won't end up being aligned to deliver what we need in healthcare.
I think the one other thing I'll throw out that did come up on several occasions is we frequently see the notion of starting pilots to do a study around something when there are very similar studies that have potentially been done. So there's a lot of research. Let's try and do another example of this and see if we can get some more data around it. But the problem with pilots is they end. And so you can start to make the progress, but you look at the teams that are doing the project. And you know, at the end of the project, they're already on to the next thing. They're trying to get more funding. So I think you need to sort of get away from also the pilots that are funded through agencies and get more towards, okay, we're going to do, you know, they're sustainable. So, you know, patient-centered medical homes are a great concept. They're being funded today through pilots and grants that people are doing. So is that really going to drive provider groups to redo their workflow to be more patient-focused when it's really them applying for a grant to do that? It's not sustainable. So as soon as there's a model that people see this is how the world is going, they will respond. You know, they will adapt to that, and they'll say that, okay, this is the new world, and people will respond. So I'd say that's another example of what can be done. The world will respond to it, and you will see cost benefits from that.
Why couldn't the federal government, we're now moving into healthcare policy, which I don't really pretend to know a lot about, but why couldn't the federal government, through its, they have a pool of insurers that they have for federal employees, I think of the congressional plan, Why couldn't they just say, we're not going to accept any insurance plans to that we would essentially give unless they have all of these provisions in here around reimbursement, around remote transactions, things like that. Just basically say, as the largest buyer of healthcare services in the world, indirectly and directly, we're not going to do this anymore. Would that drive
take
anything?
That one.
I'll vote for you.
Okay.
I think that we've seen that notion has come up in a few initiatives around the world. Some of them held great promise, and a lot of money was invested to try to do that. Usually a public-private partnership of some kind, and so on and so forth. And I think that there have been a number of things. You can look at those and learn valuable lessons. One of the lessons is that it was too early a few years ago. Things are changing so quickly that you know the chance of things like that succeeding, of saying these are the minimum requirements, industry step up, and if you do, there's a pathway to success. It needs a fair amount of alignment. We never have investment with uncertainty, and there has been a significant amount of uncertainty. So there's been uncertainty about spectrum availability and bandwidth. There's been uncertainty about the FDA regulatory pathway for many innovative converged medical devices, for mobile medical apps, and therefore, you know, there's a lot of work being done on that, for interoperable components of systems, for interoperable medical devices, so that one could then build smarter devices in the home or in the hospital. And I think a lot of that uncertainty has taken the wind out of the sails of some of these grander visions. And then with the contraction of the economy, things haven't helped. In my opinion, there is a lot that can be done with the procurement power of our federal government to have certain things meet minimum standards. For example, for open communication interfaces, for standardized use of data, for things along those lines. And in my opinion, they should be leveraged. It's an incentive.
Goes back to your, it doesn't necessarily have to be binary. If you do this or we won't contract with you, you can also structure it to be incentive payments,
yes,
which will drive
exactly
that. So the question to Julian's point, you know, there was a point 5 years ago where people said, well, we don't have any of this infrastructure to do this, so EMRs are being rolled out right now. You're in a better position to start to do that. You can then start to provide incentives. So it doesn't have to be as binary one or the other. And I hope that people are looking at those.
Right.
I think, Rob, if I can just make a quick note about that, you know, part of the problem is what we've been beating to death here, which is the reimbursement on laws currently on the books for telehealth reimbursement for Medicare. That's a big aspect of not being able to really tap into these types of technologies and really get reimbursed for it, number one. But I think that there's a lot of hope through meaningful use, not only stage two, which you begin to see some aspects that really the only way that they're going to be able to accomplish them is through mobile, mHealth, you know, remote monitoring, et cetera. But also in stage three, as they move forward on really trying to engage patients and families through core objectives, I think we're going to start finally seeing incentives for using these types of technologies. Once it becomes part of that ecosystem, which it already is a part of, but unfortunately has been excluded because mostly it's EHR technologies, I think you're going to start seeing that type of situation where big payers are going to be able to say, hey, look, we're going to pool our resources and we want to actually adopt these technologies.
Now, I'm still waiting for to have me feel like there's any part of the healthcare system I interact with is in the 21st century. I figure when I notice it, maybe it'll mean it's real. So
the bill collectors are very efficient.
Yeah,
exactly.
No, I get it. Very last question. Really.
Yeah, Arlene Holden, Technology Policy Institute. Actually, I'll take a cut at a partial answer to your very good question, Ron. The Office of Personnel Management that runs the FEHB, the Federal Employees Health Benefit System, is also in a fiduciary relationship of kind of with federal employees, and really needs to consider what the companies can do, what might be cost beneficial, and for them to take a strong leadership role there could be too hard, and the companies indeed might not be able to do it. And there's also, right now, as I know, getting back to your question on pilots, there's a lot of pilot studies that show huge cost savings to health IT innovation. But as far as I know, there really haven't been comprehensive controlled studies that really could be sufficiently believable for health insurance companies to take strong steps forward in coverage, nor for Medicare or Medicaid, for example, for that matter, to take strong steps. So we really need systematic studies that would show where are their, you know, what are the costs, where are they, where might the benefits lie, and, you know, how might we really approach these issues in a sensible way.
I think the chairman said it well, that there's a strong pull for this to happen eventually.
Yes.
And what's really in front of us today is how do we accelerate it in a sensible way, as opposed to waiting for it to magically aggregate. And to along those lines, we're starting to see that organizations are implementing this even without the vast evidence. So we see that with the VA. The VA has a large telemedicine program. Kaiser, other organizations, Partners has a strong telehealth program through the Connected Health program, especially for congestive heart failure, Geisinger. So in a sense, we're seeing the movement because people know that it's right for a lot of little reasons. We don't have the very clear, very powerful explanations. And the other thing I think that's missing are we have an absence of turnkey solutions. It takes a lot to make these things work. It's really difficult, and therefore it's still expensive. And some succeed and some fail. So the absence of good turnkey solutions probably will also change in the near future. And certainly many are trying to solve that.
I just want to say really quickly, there's a group within NIH that's really trying to grapple with this issue of good social sciences research. The Office of Behavioral and Social Sciences Research, they're actually trying to put together a public-private partnership currently, which it goes back to one of the recommendations that we had, that the FCC should invest in those public-private partnerships, such as the ones being formulated by NIH, and when one being formulated, actually, that's already in process with the FDA, because the science behind this, the proper research to really qualify and quantify the benefits, I think, is really of utmost importance.
Right.
So, I think, Arlene, one of the problems is that in all those studies, they value your time as worth zero. And if your time were actually valued, it would make change things a lot because, you know, it's, if I can do something in 3 minutes instead of an hour and a half, I think your mother example is your mother's time is valued.
And Deborah filling out the forms this morning in the office and everyone else. And by the way, clinicians' time isn't valued either. You know, we're not sure whose time is valued, but we know whose time isn't valued.
So this is such a great conversation today. I certainly learned a lot and am more hopeful than I came in spite of the barriers and the problems. Maybe it's one of those things where we're just, as they say, at the tipping point, and with the FCC's leadership and others and, well, your efforts. I also want to say I think that we should double your salaries as serving on this task force because your job has been so great. I really appreciate all the time you all put into this pro bono. And thank you all for coming. Please give me a hand.
Thank you.
Good job.
Yeah, a gift to you.
A gift.